This week on Sneak Previews, we sort through the 12 months just passed to give you our picks for the very best and the very worst movies of 1992. Years from now, not even the most optimistic historian could look back at 1992 and call it a great year for movies. Ah, but hidden among the disappointments and mediocrities, there have been some memorable films, which, because so much else was forgettable, stand out all the more. And this week, we salute those achievements by presenting our choices for the year's best and, oh yes, the worst films of the year as well. I'm Jeffrey Lyons.
And I'm Michael Medved, and this year we've arranged our picks for Best of 92 according to the order in which they were released. And I'm up first, going back to the early months of this year to look at some remarkable but underappreciated pictures that you may have missed. Alan and Naomi, which is now on home video, deserved far more attention than it received when it played in theaters. This is a heart-wrenching story of an emotionally scarred young Holocaust survivor who arrives in New York in 1944 and whose incomparably touching friendship with a teenager from across the hall, beautifully played by Lucas Haas, gradually helps her to return to normal life. Howard's End is the latest triumph from the great producer-director team of Ismael Merchant and James Ivory, who are best known for the glorious Room with a View. Like that earlier film, Howard's End is adapted from a novel by E.M. Forster, and its complicated plot includes an unexpected romance between a widower business tycoon, played by last year's Oscar winner Anthony Hopkins, and a feisty intellectual, played by a very likely Oscar nominee for this year, Emma Thompson. A Midnight Clear used an extraordinary fairy tale atmosphere to tell its haunting story of a lonely squad of American GIs in the French mountains in Christmas of 1944. They're sent out to bring back information on an expected enemy attack when they discover two bodies, one German, one American, frozen in a mysterious embrace.
Jimmy Brunowski from Griffin's Patrol. Looks like you finally found a date.
I don't get it, Juan.
When it comes to sheer visual splendor, no movie this year could touch Enchanted April, the absolutely enchanting British import based on a 1923 novel, featuring stunning newcomer Polly Walker, Alfred Molina, and Joan Plowright in an uplifting story about four women who renew their tired lives during a magical vacation at an Italian villa. Then there was Clint Eastwood's moody, brilliant Western, Unforgiven. Gene Hackman plays a sadistic sheriff who confronts Eastwood, a gunslinger who's gone straight, but is gradually drawn back into his nightmarish former life.
Killed just about everything that walks or crawled at one time or another. And I'm here to kill you, little Bill, for what you did to Ned. Boys better move away.
All right, gentlemen. He's got one barrel left. When he fires that, take out your pistols and shoot him down like the mangy scoundrel he is.
I'm not surprised you picked Unforgiven on your list. I didn't much care for the film, but I respect Clint Eastwood's work as a director, particularly here, but also as an actor. He's a strong Oscar candidate, so is Gene Hackman. I found the film much too dark and haunting and brutal, but I think that may be what appealed to you about it.
It's absolutely correct. I mean, the fact is, this is a remarkably complex Western. I mean, every character is a combination of good and evil. It's a film about repentance, the possibility or impossibility of putting your life together. And I don't think I've ever seen a motion picture, ever, that more immediately, more sensually, more powerfully conveyed how horrible it might actually be to kill another human being.
Well, I have, and the picture is called The Midnight Clear, which was also on your list. Not on mine, but I like the film very much.
Yeah.
Didn't play very long. It had a small budget.
Shoestring budget.
Yeah, not terribly well-known actors, but gave the sense of the horrors of war, particularly the Battle of the Bulge, which was a late war in World War II, a late battle in the history of World War II, where a lot of German soldiers were crossed over and wore American uniforms, and kids died, needlessly say some. It was a fascinating film.
Well, Well, of course, this film is about a German squad who basically wants to surrender but doesn't quite know how to do that, and the whole atmosphere of Christmas is so hauntingly conveyed. A great piece of work by Keith Gordon, the young director, who people will remember from the silly movie School Days, where he played Rodney Dangerfield's son. He's come a long way,
right?
And a very promising director to create something like this on a shoestring budget.
But watching Howard Zinn, a film which I adored, I found it a tiny bit too long and slow-moving, but so what? Thank goodness somebody somewhere still has the courage to put money into a project like this, knowing it'll have to play months at so-called art houses to make its money back, which it is doing across the country now. It's lavish, and also you live the lives of these people, so that when later on in the film, relationships develop, you remember things that happened early on and you can understand everything.
Well,
it moves wonderfully.
The film is so juicy, it's so passionate. There are surprises and plot twists that abound in this picture. And I think a lot of people have the idea that it's some kind of stuffy costume drama because it's set in Edwardian England. I don't think there's a more passionate movie made this year, except perhaps if it's another costume drama, Enchanted April. I love this picture. You come out of it feeling renewed and invigorated, like you've been on a vacation yourself.
We'll be seeing more of Enchanted April and Alan and Naomi in just a minute, as they say. Michael, when I compile my list, in fact, for best films of the year, and go back to the beginning of the year, I found the first one to be the very picture which led off your list. Indeed, Alan and Naomi. I love this movie, especially for its tenderness. Lucas Haas worked wonderfully with Vanessa Zaoui, and their relationship developed in a gradual way so that when the characters do interact, you believe it.
But my favorite is how you sing to me.
Late June brought A League of Their Own, directed by Penny Marshall, which told a little-known part of baseball history, the birth of the Women's Professional Baseball League, a wartime gimmick devised to maintain interest in baseball in small Midwestern cities, which actually lasted until 1954. Tom Hanks as the boozy manager, Gina Davis, and in a small role, Madonna, were delightful in a movie which showed that baseball wasn't always a world of petulant millionaire players. I, too, chose Enchanted April to be on my best list. It actually was the one movie I saw twice in 1992. This is the story not simply of four women who dared to leave their humdrum lives for a two-week vacation, but it was that rare film which brought the viewer into that sense of escape at a sun-drenched villa. I can still feel that Italian sun beating down on me.
He's the gardener. It's good to be independent and to know exactly what one wants.
It saves time.
But you shouldn't be too independent that people have no chance to be generous. You know, I hadn't realized you were so pretty.
That's very kind of you to say so.
You're really quite lovely.
I hope you make the most of it. Yes, I've been making the most of it ever since I can remember.
Because it won't last.
I know. I mustn't miss breakfast.
Don't go soft.
But there was nothing beautiful about South Central, just extremely powerful. In a year of some fine films about the African-American experience, like Malcolm X and Zebrahead, this one rose above the rest, telling of a leader of a tough L.A. street gang sentenced to a decade in prison, then determined to save his young son from a similar fate. It was a tough movie about a tragedy sweeping too many American families. South Central didn't play long in theaters this fall, but it will soon be available on home video. Mistress, on the other hand, was a whimsical look at the bizarre way movies are sometimes financed and produced. Robert Wall played a screenwriter whose old script was discovered by a washed-up producer, who then shops it around, and one of the potential underwriters is Robert De Niro, with his own vision of the story.
Sexual obsessions begin to dominate and destroy his life.
Photographer?
I changed the painter into a photographer. It's much more contemporary. He should be photographing nude women. His art and his sexuality should be forever fighting and chained together, distorting each other's emotions, and just, that's the way I see it.
You know, De Niro's not an actor who's normally known for his comic gifts, but he's very funny in this movie, which I liked enormously, and I'm really glad that you picked it. Partially because The Player, which in many ways is a similar kind of film purporting to be an inside view of Hollywood, is getting so much attention. It's won some of the major critics' award. I think this is a better picture, partially because it has affection for its characters. They're portrayed as sort of lovable eccentrics. It's a world of low-budget, shoestring production, and everybody's very funny in the movie, particularly De Niro and Martin Landau.
The Player was so concerned with having hundreds of cameos that it became an insider picture itself, for my money. Not that I didn't like it, but this picture still has a small feeling to it, and you get the feeling this picture itself had an uphill struggle to get made.
It did.
And Robert Wall is so good as the screenwriter. He really is, and Martin Landau works well with him, and De Niro really steals
the
film.
Directed and written by a very fine actor named Barry Primus, who again, like Keith Gordon, who we mentioned before, is going to have a terrific future as a director. And speaking of future as a director, Steve Anderson, his first feature, South Central, what an impressive movie this is, partially because the central character, Glenn Plummer, is one of those great rarities where you see a character, a soul, change before your eyes, and that's profoundly moving.
I was waiting to see if his transformation would be believable, and it sure was. It happens in prison. He meets a man who went through a tragedy in his own life, who converts him much the same way as we saw him in Malcolm X. And this
more
film,
convincingly
right,
here, I
this,
thought.
This film was also produced by Oliver Stone, who also produced Zebrahead, another film about the African-American experience. But this film got me, maybe because it got very little play, mm-hmm. played very briefly. It came and went. It'll soon be coming out on video, but it's about the missing father figure in too many American families.
And certainly a powerful picture and well worth seeing. And speaking of the opposite, a film that got plenty of play,
made
and
a lot
was
of
a
money.
Big hit, was A League of Their Own. And, you know, it's amazing for me to actually see a film with Madonna,
yep.
who is not my favorite actress,
nor
that
mine.
I liked enormously.
Use the word actress loosely.
Right. But she's good in the picture. She's perfectly
Absolutely.
Convincing.
Absolutely. Good for
she
her to be an ensemble player. Yeah, here, in one scene, she's actually arguing that the baseball uniforms are too skimpy.
Right.
And for her to do it is kind of an inside
That's
joke,
a
but
big
it works.
Stretch. It's a big stretch. The fact is, I think that the success of A League of Their Own and the success of Enchanted April show and highlight the tremendous shortage we have today of terrific parts for women. These were two very successful, wonderful pictures that had rich women parts. And, you know, the fact is that if you look at the Screen Actors Guild figures, 72% of all speaking roles in movies today go to men. I think that these two excellent films show that's too much and not fair.
You and your stats. Of course, baseball is the stat game, and I thought I knew everything about the game, rather. And this was a part of baseball history which really has gotten no play at all. And alas, some of the women who are depicted in the movie have just died, but thank goodness they live to see
and
A League of Their Own.
Speaking of some of the women, Polly Walker, who we should mention,
oh, yeah.
who's that gorgeous new star from Enchanted April, we're going to be hearing a lot from her in the years to come. Well, rounding out my list of the best, we come to some better-known movies released later in the year, in fall and winter, and I begin right here with the only comedy of the year that actually made me laugh out loud. In Honeymoon in Vegas, writer-director Andrew Bergman, who also made The Freshman, created a screwball romance in which professional gambler James Caan wins a big poker hand from unsuspecting Nicolas Cage and suggests an unconventional means of paying off the debt, involving Cage's fiancée, Sarah Jessica Parker.
I want... your girlfriend for the weekend.
Betsy? Mm-hmm. How do you know Betsy?
No, I don't know Betsy. I saw her over there in the lobby. See, my wife, Donna, may she rest in peace. They look identical. I mean, they could be twins. Now, I'm willing to, you know, wipe out the 65 bills. You let me spend the weekend with her.
The Last of the Mohicans became a surprise box office hit with its lavishly romantic adaptation of James Fenimore Cooper's novel about the French and Indian War. Madeline Stowe and Daniel Day-Lewis created memorable chemistry, while the violent scenes were gripping but never exploitative, suiting the frontier subject matter. Director Michael Mann's epic spectacle provided a feast for lovers of old-fashioned adventure movies. Aladdin was a feast for everybody, from the smallest kids to grown-up romantics, to fans of Robin Williams' outrageous shtick as the voice of the most memorable genie to ever jump out of a lamp.
10,000 years will give you such a crick in the neck.
So what'll it be, Master?
I must have hit my head harder than I thought.
The holiday season is usually associated with feel-good family movies like Aladdin, but Lorenzo's Oil, released on Christmas Day, is in many ways the opposite experience, one of the most profoundly disturbing and most unforgettable movies I've ever seen. Susan Sarandon plays the mother of a 6-year-old boy stricken with a rare, always fatal disease who refuses to give up hopes of his recovery.
I beg your pardon.
Nothing.
Get out.
Look, Mrs. Adoni.
Just get out.
I've read up on this disease. I know what it's done to his brain.
Lower your voice. Lorenzo doesn't need to hear this from a subluteal with a double-digit IQ.
Face it, lady. The lights are out and there's nobody home.
Just get out. Go.
Well, Merry Christmas.
Get out.
Happy holidays. And a joyous...
Near a great forest lived a poor woodcutter with his two children, Hansel and Gretel. Times were very hard, and a day came when there was no food except a little stale bread. But Hansel was like you, my darling. He was a clever lad who knew how to solve difficult problems.
Finally, I urge everyone to see The Quarrel, a remarkably intense, deeply moving, low-budget gem just released at the end of the year. Two old friends, both Holocaust survivors, played by Saul Rubinek and E.F. Thompson, meet by chance in a Montreal park after the war, and they argue over the most important questions of life and faith.
How, in the name of any kind of justice, can you continue to believe in this cruel god of yours?
Of course I believe. You, Chaim, can only imagine a believer having faith in the middle of a beautiful forest with oranges. You can't imagine that God also exists in desert and with desolation. What do you want?
That I should believe in the greatness of God because only he, well, not a human being, could bring such destruction? You see miracles in catastrophes.
See them. You know, this is the last movie I saw in 1992, and I came away mesmerized. I'm so glad you picked it.
Thank you.
It is a thought-provoking film. It is the kind of movie that few people have the courage to make. It is a movie which deals with age-old questions and doesn't necessarily answer them, but it addresses them head-on, and what bravura performances by two actors in essentially a two-character play. And where else do they make movies like that today? It's made in a Canadian setting. It's set in Montreal with mostly unknown people involved in the film, and it is just an undiscovered gem.
Well, it's also, it's not only about ideas. It's not sort of musty. It's about a friendship. And my gosh, if anybody sees this thing to the end and isn't reduced to tears, there's something wrong with them. It is one of the most moving things you're going to see this year. It deals with a question of faith. So does Lorenzo's Oil, which is one of the things I liked so much about it. The struggle of the couple in the movie, played by Nick Nolte and Susan Sarandon, beautifully played by both of them, to try to maintain their faith, to ask for God's help, to try to deal with the tragedy of this little boy who seems irreversibly in a coma.
Well, Lorenzo's Oil is an uplifting film, too, in many ways. You go through the ordeal with the parents. Along the way, you get a knowledge of some of the aspects of this rare disease, and it's a true story. The actors are more than up to the challenge of portraying these real courageous people without making them saintly in any way. They have beautiful, believable faults, but the characters themselves have three dimensions, and in the end, you walk out of the theater, at least I did, saying, my God, thanks for that my children don't have this problem, but also, this is acceptable, this is believable, this really can happen.
You really do want to hug your own family more closely. And talk about three-dimensional characters, larger-than-life characters, Last of the Mohicans. What a glorious visual experience this was. I mean, I loved every frame of the movie. And you know what? Some of the performances, I thought Daniel Day-Lewis was miscast. I'll give you that. But I thought some of the performances, particularly by Wes Studi, who's going to get an Oscar or at least a nomination.
You mean for Holding Up the Heart? That you're saying this picture, you said the violence
I think the violence is suitable to the frontier setting. I mean, this is not a prettified picture of Native American life like Dances with Wolves was in many ways. This is a far more accurate, balanced, fascinating approach.
Like the two characters in The Quarrel. Here's where we part company here. I mean, I thought this
I believe you don't.
This was a beautiful-looking movie. I thought it was Tarzan of the Alleghenies coming out of the forest, doing modern kung fu techniques against all. But still, it was a very big hit. A lot of people, a lot of women wanted to see Daniel Day-Lewis running around in a loincloth. And I'm happy for one reason or another that you like
it's stirring to watch. You don't get to see James Caan in a loincloth and Honeymoon in Vegas, but you do, fortunately, but you do get to see a terrific performance. He's very funny, and I've never liked Nicolas Cage as much as I did in this film.
And I, too, loved Aladdin, as we will soon see. Michael, leading off my list of movies, which open in the second half of the year, is a film about a young man forced to confront his own identity, then face up to people he thought were his friends, but who suddenly turned against him. Some people I know thought school ties with Brendan Fraser as a transfer student at a posh New England boarding school in the 50s too pretty a movie. But that's the irony, I thought, since the sleek veneer masks the ugly stench of anti-Semitism. Here, for instance, Fraser's Jewish identity has accidentally been revealed, and he must confront the prejudices of his roommate.
The first day I came to this place, I thought I was dreaming. I knew it was only going to be for a year, but I thought, man, what a year. I get into Harvard. And it's not all that easy when you come from Podunk Public High School. You guys were my friends. We were winning games. I met Sally. I didn't want anything to mess it up. I didn't want to be told that I couldn't be a part of it because I was a Jew. Can you understand that? It's happened before.
You could have told us. It wouldn't have made a difference.
A river runs through it, meanwhile, is a story of two brothers growing up together in Missoula, Montana, the sons of a Presbyterian minister 70 years ago. Based on a true story and then a book, and directed and narrated by Robert Redford, it looks a bit like a gorgeous travelogue. Ah, but the sweep of the scenery itself was an important character in this unforgettable movie. But it was a different train ride altogether, an Alberto Express, set mostly on a train heading from Paris to Rome. This offbeat Italian comedy is only now getting a gradual national release. But it's a very funny story of a young man who's been given every single bill and receipt his father had saved raising him, and has only the length of this train ride to steal, borrow, or beg for enough money to pay Papa back. Half a world away in what was then French Indochina, the French movie Indochine was shot with Catherine Deneuve, as radiant as ever. She plays a prosperous plantation owner during the waning years of French colonialism, forced to raise the orphan daughter of her closest friend. The twists and turns the lives of these women take are as dramatic as the evolution of Southeast Asia itself. And I, too, picked Aladdin, the only holiday release I was able to recommend without any reservations for every member of the family. But beyond that, this is that rare movie which adults ought to see on their own to enjoy some terrific musical numbers.
Ammunition in your camp.
We got some punk.
Yahoo and Halsey, all you gotta do is rub that lamp.
And I say,
Mr. Aladdin, sir, what will your pleasure be?
Let me take your order, jot it down.
You ain't never had a friend like me.
Seeing that scene again, of course, it makes me eager to go back and see Aladdin again. You know, I'll take my kids again. I mean, the fact is, this is a wonderful picture. My only reservation about the picture at all is to say that it's not quite as great and timeless as Beauty and the Beast.
Oh, I liked it better. I think it's for adults, too, who can laugh at things that their kids won't be laughing at, and the kids can laugh at the adults, and Robin Williams is sensational.
You know, when you're talking about this level of gratitude that you have for a film like Aladdin, even if you agree with me that it's not as great as Beauty and the Beast, one's still enormously grateful for it. And frankly, I was grateful that you took Indochine on your list, because it brings up another film that I wanted to choose but didn't quite make my list, called The Lover. Both of them are French films, both made in Vietnam. Indochine is a more sweeping film with more of a political element and a more melodramatic plot. The Lover, based on Marguerite Duras's novel and her recollections, right, is a more intimate focus. But both films have a very haunting quality and gorgeous leading ladies.
Yeah, and also, a lot of people are going to either reject the premise of Alberto Express right on or not. I suspect they won't. The beginning of this movie has Papa calling the son into the dining room and sitting him down in front of an adding machine and bringing out these bills, and then he presses the button marked grand total, or in Italian, totale generale, and you see the machine going like that, and we realize just how expensive it is to raise kids.
Well,
what they owe is in dollars and cents, if nothing else.
This is broad comedy. This is where I got to part company with you a little bit. Broad comedy is a matter of taste. It depends on whether people thoroughly enjoy this young leading man, Sergio Castellitto.
He's great.
He mugs a lot.
Yes,
I mean,
and that's what the role calls for.
Sometimes very funny. And again, I'm glad you picked A River Runs Through It. As remember, it was a best bet on our show. I liked the picture, though I did say at the time, it's true that A River Runs Through It, but it runs through very slowly.
My only
hesitation about this
picture.
You know,
Robert Redford's narration helped move the story along. I have the feeling they may have filmed it without the narration and realized that familiar voice and that fine presence, even without appearing on camera, is what's needed to make this a very good picture.
Well, he was very respectful of the novel by Norman MacLean, the novella, the recollection book by MacLean, and I think maybe too respectful, because the film has that quality of memory with no real dramatic arc. But it's a very fine film. Brad Pitt, who plays the younger brother, is surely going to get an Oscar nomination for Best Supporting Actor. Where I really part company with you, School Ties. I just thought the film was a little bit too pat by making the Brendan Fraser character, and Brendan Fraser is very good, so perfect, so handsome, so noble.
Well, he's not perfect because he doesn't have the courage to reveal his Jewish identity or his religious background early on, which would have solved all the problems.
Yeah, but
perhaps.
It's like those old films of the 50s and the 60s where he's so lovable that it makes the prejudice seem totally incomprehensible.
I didn't find that at all. I found the look of it, though, fascinating, and it's so beautiful looking. Underneath it is this ugly veneer, this ugly stench of anti-Semitism.
I think in some ways it'll remind people of A Gentleman's Agreement meets Dead Poets Society.
Much more powerful.
Well, so looking back on our respective choices of the best of the year, where we just disagreed a little bit about School Ties, we both did list Alan and Naomi and Aladdin as top picks. And something else happened in 1992, for the very first time in all of the 8 years we've been working together on sneak previews, and that is we both chose the same movie as this year's very best. And that movie, ta-da, is director Mike Newell's glowing and glorious Enchanted April.
But Michael, for every Enchanted April we were lucky to have seen this year, we had to wade through a morass of cinematic muck. So here are my choices for the worst movies of the year. Number 10, Mom and Dad Save the World with Terry Garr and John Lovitz wasted. Christopher Columbus, The Discovery, the first and last time Marlon Brando and Tom Selleck will probably ever co-star. Number 8, Man Trouble with Jack Nicholson as a crooked dog trainer. Newsies, an insipid musical with choreography resembling a bad exercise video. And 3 bloodsucker movies, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Innocent Blood, and Sleepwalkers, which added incest to the mix, for goodness sake. And speaking of the undead, there was the long-delayed Brenda Starr with Brooke Shields. And number 2 is is Ladybugs with Rodney Dangerfield coaching a girls' soccer team. But my pick for the worst movie of the year was Radio Flyer, a nasty, scary picture about child abuse, but advertised as a kid's adventure movie.
Jeffrey, you mentioned Rodney Dangerfield, deservedly, and that gives me a chance to correct my own bonehead error from earlier in the show when I misidentified the movie in which he starred with Keith Gordon. The real name of the movie, of course, is Back to School. Well, back to the worst of the year list, and my list was a real challenge this year because 1992 brought such a bumper crop of bad movies. So to try to do justice to this very rich field, I've deliberately avoided duplicating any of the titles that showed up on Jeffrey's list. So I start with the other Christopher Columbus movie, 1492, The Conquest of Paradise, with Gerard Depardieu delivering his lines in no known language. Night and the City with Robert De Niro and Jessica Lange, and a slice of life movie that's actually a slice of baloney. Brian De Palma's Raising Kane, which raised only laughs at John Lithgow's hilarious overacting. And Toys, the worst Christmas confection since Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. And Children of the Corn 2, which managed the amazing feat of turning out even worse than the original Children of the Corn. And then Shadows and Fog, one more low point in what's been a very rough year for poor Woody Allen. And Wild Orchid 2, Two Shades of Blue, which was more than two shades of awful, while Cuffs starred a sneering Christian Slater as the most obnoxious cop of the year. And talk about obnoxious, the entire cast of Alien 3 was so hateful that you're rooting for the monster to eat them all up quickly. While Cool World won my coveted Worst of the Year designation for its incoherent, ugly blend of animation and live action, with the real Kim Basinger even less lifelike than the cartoon version of the star.
That's it for our best and the worst of the year. Join us next time, won't you, for sneak previews when we look at some of the new movies in town. I'm Jeffrey Lyons.
And I'm Michael Medved. So until next time, don't forget to save us those aisle seats.
It's an evening of travel and adventure on...